Matthew chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Matthew chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Tonight we're going to begin to focus in on perfect parenting. Perfect parenting. Perfect parenting. Matthew chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. And as we begin to open up on this section of scripture, Matthew 3, 16 and 17, the background to Matthew 3, 16 and 17 is the birth of the Lord and Savior, the baptism of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so I want to reach in and grab this comment as we begin to focus in on perfect parenting from Matthew 3, verse 16 and 17. In Matthew 3, verse 16, it says, after being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and lighting on him. And behold, a voice out of heaven said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. At the baptism of Jesus Christ, you're going to see two things take place. The Holy Spirit is going to land on Jesus Christ at his baptism. The presence of the Holy Spirit is going to land on him at the baptism. And then the next thing you're going to see is that you're going to see the heavens opened up, and the Bible says that a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son with whom I'm well pleased. Now, when we talk about parenting, a lot of times people may not realize how serious parenting is to God, may not recognize how serious God views parenting. If you flip back, and we're not going to just spend a lot of time there tonight, but if you go all the way back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 through 28, just like we did in marriage, and we defined the meaning of marriage in Genesis 1, 26 through 28, is that our marriages were to be a reflection of the image of God. And watch, our parenting is designed to be a reproduction of the image of God. Parenting is designed to be a reproduction of the image of God. And God blessed them, and God said, be fruitful and multiply. And God created children in his image. And notice that God said a comment that was made in your Bible in Genesis 1, 26 to 28 is, he said, be fruitful and multiply. He did not just say multiply. He said, be fruitful and multiply. The fruitful aspect of it is where the spiritual realm of God's presence is hovering in and on the life of your child, because your child is an image bearer or a reflection of God. And so just because we have children does not mean that we've been fruitful in multiplying. Walk with me to Genesis chapter 6 real quick. In Genesis chapter 6, there's a danger in parenting that we'll talk about in a couple of weeks. But in Genesis chapter 6, verse 1, if people read their Bible real fast, you're going to miss what just took place. He said, now it came about when men began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them. The sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful. They took wives, plural, for themselves, whomever they chose. Genesis chapter 6, verse 1 is a bad statement. It's a bad statement. It said when men began to multiply on the face of the earth. What it did not say is that men were being fruitful and multiplying. It said men were just having babies. There was no fruitful aspect of it. They were physically producing children. They were physically procreating, but they weren't spiritually building anything. So it is in this chapter where God decides, I'm going to bring a flood, and I'm going to wipe out all of humankind except eight people, four husbands and four wives. And God wipes out everybody, as Jesus talks about it in Matthew, from grandma and grandpa all the way down to the newest born baby. God wipes off everybody. Why? Because men were just multiplying. They weren't being fruitful in multiplying. God's original mandate when he talked about us having children was, I want you to be fruitful and multiply. And in essence, through your parenting, reproduce the image of God as you model God to your children. As your marriage is a reflection or a mirror of God, then your children see God in their parents' marriage, and they look to it and they say, we see the image of God in our parents' marriage. We see the blessing of God because God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. So your children are looking at you and they're seeing the reflection of God on your life, on my life. And as a result, they say, we want to represent God. That's the way God set it up. He said, he blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. Genesis 6, it says, men began to multiply. The spiritual aspect had been removed. Is that we're just having babies because we like these women. But we're not raising any children to the glory of God. And so as a result, we got to be very careful that when we're laying around with people, we're not just multiplying with no intention to be fruitful. And some of the problems that we're having in the streets right now with our people is that we're multiplying, we're not being fruitful and multiplying. And the reason why we have a lot of foolishness throughout the earth is because people are playing around with God's institution of marriage and sex. And when you play around with God's institution of marriage and sex, you are literally reproducing death in the earth realm. You're producing kids and children that are destroying generations to come because the parents did not take their job seriously. Walk with me to Genesis chapter 9 real quick. How serious is God? God is so serious about what he asked us to do. Is he said, I want you to reproduce my image on the face of the earth through your children. And since I decided that y'all haven't done it, I'm going to bring this flood and I'm going to kill everybody. Is the Bible uses the term blot out everybody from the face of the earth. And God takes everybody out. But then God recommissions in Genesis 9, verse 1 and 2. Watch these words, and you've heard them before. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Did you catch that? God comes back after the flood. And I want y'all to notice real quickly, in Genesis 6, he said, when man began to multiply on earth. So y'all, God, can I be real with you? God is so amazing, is that, watch God on the hookup. You can have a baby out of wedlock and God can still hook it up and put the baby in the lineage of Jesus Christ. So when you read Genesis chapter 38, verse 12 through 19, write that down. You need to write that down if you ain't wrote nothing down. Genesis 38, 12 through 19, there's a man by the name of Judah who's going to end up sleeping with his daughter-in-law, who's disguised as a woman of the night, Tamar, and through this incestuous, deceitful relationship, they end up having twins out of wedlock. Judah went by for a quickie and didn't realize he was getting ready to produce something that was going to live a long time. Y'all read your Bible. And what comes out of it is these two babies. And these two twins, write this down next to it, find themselves in Matthew chapter 1, verses about 1 through 5, in the lineage of Jesus Christ. Here's the good news of God. God can take every single one of our mistakes and turn it into a miracle. Now, so God takes this situation. But here's what he does in the original, Genesis 9. I want y'all to know I'm serious about you being fruitful and multiplying. So I'm going to come back in Genesis 9, 1 and 2 and remind you of what I told you in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 through 28. So the reason why God kills and destroys all those babies and all those parents and all those grandparents is because you all have disobeyed my mandate as parents and grandparents to raise up godly offspring. Now, do you realize how many people died? When you read Genesis chapter 5, the Bible says Methuselah was 969 years of age. You're now talking about people living before the flood, before the effects of the sun beating men down. People living 700, 800 years. You got millions of people, 6 million to 16 million people on the face of the earth, and God kills all of them except 8. See, and if he killed them all because he was displeased with them, hell starts out with a big number in it. Heaven starts out with a small number. Hell just scored the biggest touchdown you ever saw at the flood. How many points y'all got? 16 million. And God saved 8 people. And he said, now, I saved 8, Noah, because you're righteous. I considered you a righteous man. And when I saved those 8 people because I considered you a righteous man, I'm going to give you another mandate. And that is to reproduce my image and be fruitful and multiply one more time. And if you read chapter 9, verse 1, what does it say? Somebody read it. God bless who? And who? Notice that he didn't say he blessed the wives. He said he blessed the men who were responsible to raising up their children to the glory of God. Now, ladies, I hope that you heard me, because he does not mention you in this second blessing, because the man you're with is designed to be the man who leads your family to raise up these children. Ladies, how does that practically work out, Pastor? It works out this good. If the Negro you dating can't do that, drop him. Do you hear what I'm saying? You ain't reading no good Bible like I'm reading. He didn't say anything about the wife in that second blessing. He said, God bless Noah and his 3 sons. And he told them to be fruitful and multiply, and they ain't carrying no baby. Who carrying the baby? The woman is. But I want something to come from you, man. Why? Because when I go back to Genesis chapter 6, it was y'all who were just looking around at women as if they were sex pieces. When men began to see that the women were lovely and beautiful, that's Genesis 6. They chose wives, whichever one that they wanted. So the man, he chose multiple wives. Y'all accepted that thing like it was love and hip hop. And all of a sudden, the next thing you know, he got multiple honeys and multiple babies, and he ain't raising any of them to the glory of God. And this is Genesis chapter 6. This ain't no 2017 story. God already knew we was hood. Are you following me? God knew that you weren't serious. So, ladies, you need to know who you picking. Are you following me? I don't care what he look like, how ugly or how good looking, and how you think of him. Beauty ain't in the eye, behold, that ain't real. The real deal is he ugly, but the deal is he not just physically ugly, he's spiritually ugly to God. And you're taking a spiritually ugly dude and letting him put himself inside of you and then leaving you with a baby, and you wonder, like, why are you the 17th million woman left with a baby? Your stuff is not that good for him to stay with you. Are you really following me? And God took it so serious that he killed everybody. Amen? Genesis 9, 1 and 2. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you and the terror of you will be on every beast of the earth and on every bird of the sky, with everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea, in your hand they are given to you. Now, he comes back in Genesis 9, 1 and 2 and says, everything that I wanted you to do in Genesis 1, 26 to 28, I'm setting it up for it to happen. And I want you men to lead these families and be great spiritual leaders in raising up your children to the image and the glory of God. Number one goal, women, if you ain't ever seen it in all your life, it's right there in the Bible, that ought to change who you choose. Now, let's walk to Matthew 3, verse 16 and 17. The perfect parent. Matthew 3, verse 16. Jesus is being baptized. And it says, after being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water. And behold, the heavens were opened. And he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and lighting on him. And behold, a voice out of heaven said this, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Perfect parenting. The perfect parenting. Watch this. The perfect parent parented with affection and affirmation through verbal and public applause. The perfect parent parented with affection and affirmation through verbal and public applause. Notice that God the Father, the perfect parent, speaks of Jesus, and the very first thing he says, "This is my beloved Son with whom I'm well pleased." He expresses affection verbally towards Jesus. Now, in other words, he begins to put the words of affection and affirmation on Jesus's life, but not only on his life, but in front of everybody. The way he talked about Jesus, the way he talked to Jesus. Now, Proverbs literature will tell you that the power of life and death is in the tongue. What you say and what comes out of your mouth as a parent towards your child is going to impact them forever. What you say to your son, what you say to your daughter is going to impact them forever. Choose your words very wisely. Choose your words very wisely. You say things that don't affirm and don't show affection towards your child will remember those things. They will remember them forever. I'll never, ever forget the story of my boy from college whose dad, they're down there from Louisiana area and all that kind of jazz. He got the light bright sisters and all that kind of stuff and families all light brights. And he came out brown and chocolate with curly, wavy hair. And his dad, because he was the only non-light skinned member of the family, called him Diablos Negro, little black devil, little black devil. He's the dark-skinned member of the family. And he always remembered that. He's all the way getting his master's in business school, and he's trying to go back and drops out of his MBA program while his dad is sick, dying on a bed with cancer. And his light, bright sisters who live down in Beaumont won't take care of dad, and the darky from San Marcos got to go take care of dad. And he's waiting for his dad to say something nice to him and affirm him because his dad back in the day called him Diablos Negro his entire life. And the man is now moving on an executive trail in business, but he's just trying to get his dad to say something decent about him. God the Father said about Jesus the Son, "This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased." Jesus heard it and everybody else heard it. Now watch this. He had affection towards his son. He had affirmation towards his son when he talked to him. And so this begins to lay out to you and I to think through what are the words that we're using to build and to invest into our children. Are we building them or are we breaking them? That's critical to what is being done. Because here's the deal. If you were talked to bad by your parents, and talked about bad by your parents, there's a high propensity that you're going to pass the same nonsense down to your kid, even if you know Jesus. Because it is your natural experience and your observational reality is this is what you think that life was. And so you do the exact same thing. So here's the deal. The perfect parent. So we want to make sure that when we start parenting, that we have affectionate and affirming words towards our children. Amen. John 5. I want to show you something about why it is important what you model to your kids as parents, how it impacts them. Because parenting involves your next generation or your legacy, your child is coming behind you, and your kids will naturally love you. They will naturally love you. My mom taught school for 38 years, and my mom said one of the worst days of her teaching career was when a young girl was playing outside on the playground, and the kids were running and playing chase, and the girl reached out to touch the girl, but she actually tore the back of her t-shirt, and she had all these bruises on her back. And so they have to report that at the school as a teacher. And so people came out to get the daughter. The daughter's back was, you're talking about third grade, beat like she had been just, you know, just beat down. People ask me, man, did you watch Good Times growing up? I said, no, I had to leave Good Times alone. And you know why I left Good Times alone? I don't remember any Good Times shows. How many of y'all Good Times fans? Y'all think I ain't on this thing yet? All right. I forgot all the shows. Because once I saw Penny had gotten burnt on the back, like I had a seizure or something, I let Good Times go. I don't believe in that physical beating on and all that kind of jazz. That's nonsense. So here's the deal. Mom has to turn it in, and she says the girl is yelling and screaming as they're taking the daughter off to go with the mother that's beating on her. Kids will naturally love their parents regardless of the nonsense we do. Amen? Turn to John chapter 5 and watch Jesus. In John chapter 5, verse 19, therefore Jesus answered and was saying to them, truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself unless it is something he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, these things the Son does in like manner. Go to John 12, verse 49. John 12, verse 49. Jesus makes the statement in John 12, 49, for I did not speak on my own initiative, but the Father himself who sent me has given me a commandment as to what to say and what to speak. So Jesus basically says this, I don't do anything unless I see my Father do it. And I don't say anything unless I have heard it from my Father. Watch, the perfect child desired to be an exact imitation and reflection of his perfect Father's actions and communication. Now think about the implication of what Jesus just said. Jesus said, I don't do anything unless it's something that I see the Father doing, which lets you know that the perfect Son is watching the perfect Father. Jesus Christ is watching God the Father. He's watching the ways of God the Father. And then he says, I don't even talk on my own initiative. Nothing comes out of my mouth unless it's something I first heard from the Father, and then I say it because he said it. So now, do you understand the implication of Jesus' actions and his communications? Because now it's all based on what I saw from my Father. Let me park right here. Based on what you do and what you talk about, do you want your child to model you? Now, y'all, cut to the chase. You can already have a jacked up marriage, but do you want to mess up the next generation? See, at some point, there's got to be a level of spiritual repentance towards God. It has nothing to do with you and your wife and that nonsense. It has something to do with, do I want to be a person that my children are jacked up because I won't get right with God and model Christ in front of him by being obedient to the Heavenly Father? So now, the way my son treats women is the way I saw my dad treat women. When my dad talked to my wife, that's the way I do. And y'all, let me tell you something. I want to ask you. As a youth pastor, from anywhere working with youth ministry from 94 to 2006, full time from 99 to 2006 as a youth pastor, y'all, don't you ever think that you get away with a whole lot that your kids don't know about. Y'all, I youth pastored in two of the mega black churches on the north side of town. Youth pastored. And I, your kids know the dude that you're cheating with. They told me. They told me. When I was at Wheeler Avenue Baptist Church on the southwest side in the very beginning, Brother Blake, why is Reverend such and such sleeping with such and such? I didn't know that Reverend such and such was sleeping with. I was like, for real? Dang, you know. Brother Blake, why does my dad have condoms when he and my mama can't have children no more? When mama shut down. What he got condoms for? So let me just tell you this, just be straight up honest. When it comes down to your parenting, do not think that you're getting away with stuff that your kids ain't smart enough to pick up on. Yo, I youth pastor, they told me. They told me. So I want to go back to this communication right here, John 5:19. Jesus says, everything my Father does, that's exactly what I do. Everything my Father says, that's exactly what I say. Do you want your child to act like you? Do you want your child to talk like you? And if you don't, here's the good news. Tomorrow starts brand new mercies. We can't play with it because your child is going to model you. So let me just talk for a second because I happen to be African American. Let me just talk about this. If we think that our community is struggling with our children, I don't think they're struggling with the children. We're struggling with the parents. Because the children ain't doing nothing that they don't see the parents doing. So whatever community that you want to go into, white, Hispanic, Asian, Indian, it doesn't matter. They're going to model what the parents do. So if you want to say, man, I'm thankful that I've reproduced this type of kid. Y'all, when people reproduced bad kids in the beginning, God killed them. Killed them and the kids and the grandkids. Do you see why parenting is serious? Because God has told you this. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to reproduce my image through your marital union and your raising of children. Now, I know y'all nervous in the service right now, and I know it's tight, but it's right. I understand all that. But I want you to really hear what we're saying, because if we don't make a shift right here in the culture, we're going to push this thing and not stop this thing. So we have the ability to push this thing forward, acting fools, raising fools. And so the reason why some of us are fools is because who raised us? Now, I know it's your mama, and I can't tell you your mama, and I can't tell you your daddy, but you know, amen? You know how you were talked to. You know how you were treated. You know what you saw in your family. Now, the question is, do you want to push that forward, or do you want to do what God asked? Do you really want to do what God asked? That's the big question. Now, when it comes down to this, I need you and I to know that your children are watching to the degree that they will repeat, they will imitate, and they will reflect. Now, here's a question for y'all's table. What were the goals you had for your children when they were born? And how have those goals developed or evolved over the years? What were the goals you had for your children when they were born? And have the goals developed or evolved over the years? Amen? Y'all got about 5-10 minutes on that. If you're single, you need to have some goals. If you're single, you need to have some goals. Don't act like this ain't got nothing to do with you. You need to have some goals. All right, stop real quick. Stop real quick, and I'm going to let y'all go. I'm going to say one thing. Here we go. My son was born on April 22nd, 2010. Now, because my son was born C-section, we got to choose the date. And so we had a little time frame that we were working with. Mark Ingram, the running back from the Alabama Crimson Tide, Heisman Trophy winner, wore number 22. So did Emmitt Smith. So did my dad. And he was born on the day of the NFL draft. My goal was for my son to play for Alabama, break all the records. That was my goal, amen. And then love the Lord, you know, and love the Lord. Okay, so when you really, what I really want you to do is talk about real stuff, real goals that you kind of like had in your mind shaped, and then the movie Concussion came out and that went out to, so I had to change my stuff. I had to change it. It developed and evolved, amen, all right. Go ahead, back to y'all. I got one more for you, here we go. I'm gonna add it to you. Here's the next one. How would you describe, based on those goals and how those goals have evolved and all that, how would you describe a successful parenting job and what would the finished product / child look like? All right? How would you describe a successful parenting job and what would the finished product / child look like? Take that one. All right. Somebody give me, how would you describe a successful parenting job and what would the finished product look like? Okay, brother pastor up here.
Who's going?
He coming, Richard, right here. Hands up, brother pastor.
Testing 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, we got you.
Okay, we had a real good dynamic discussion at our table. But personally, when we said what a good parenting job would look like, you know, before I got involved spiritually in the church, I had goals for my kids was to get them educated, keep them out of trouble, not going to jail, to be able to sustain themselves, to work, to be able to stand on their own, to have their own independent ideas. That's what I would call to be successful now, knowing that God and Jesus and the spiritual life is highly important. Now, I know naturally to put God first, and then everything else would fall into place. But my initial stuff, of course, was, you know, getting them independent and being able to sustain themselves.
Okay, amen. How many people would agree with that, if that's where yours was? Okay, amen. Another one, ladies. I need a lady. A successful parenting job. Finished product. What would it look like? We got one over here.
We didn't really discuss it a lot, but I will just go forward and say that we as women have to learn to come alongside the king, the priest, and the prophet to give him his due. I had to learn that because for myself, I didn't get a chance to know my dad till I was 17, mm-hmm. actually 27.
Yeah.
So there was a great void in my life, so I didn't know what that looked like. But being around people who were, and couples who were training up their children the way that they should go, it helped me to see where I missed it.
Mm-hmm.
And then to own it, that I missed it. But for what I can just say is to give the nobleman, the man of the house, he is to be the king, the priest, and the prophet. He has the voice, and we have to learn how to come alongside him and not override him.
Mm-hmm.
And then the children can actually see the helpmeet work together side by side.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Anybody else? Yes, sir. My brother.
I'm using myself as an example. I'm single. I don't have any kids, but watching my father. My father was in the military. He spent like 30 some odd years in the military. And one of the biggest things my father instilled in me and my brother was discipline. I mean, he had education and, you know, doing the right thing, all that kind of stuff. But the biggest thing was discipline. And his thing was, if you are disciplined in doing the right thing, if you are disciplined in whatever the lesson he's trying to teach you, then pretty much everything else will fall into place. And he instilled discipline like it's nobody's business. My father raised his household is pretty much like a military installation, because that's pretty much what he knew. That's what he did. That's what he worked. So in doing that, he instilled his children, again, he stressed discipline so much. And I'm actually proud to say today, as I'm 44 years old today, that one of those things that that I've able to take from him was stay away from negative people, stay away from drugs, stay away from alcohol, stay away from those kinds of bad things, those bad influences that could deter you into, you know, sin or you know, whatever consequences, jail time, death, whatever the case. So from what I've learned from my father, I think discipline plays a very big part of that.
Amen. Amen. Let me ask y'all this question. I'll get you. How many of y'all right now could draw an Oreo cookie? I'm not saying good. I'm not saying you could do a good job with it. But how many of you all know exactly what an Oreo cookie looks like and you could draw one? I ain't talking about all these 95 new flavors. I'm just talking about the regular Oreo cookie. All right, chocolate, white in the middle, chocolate. Here's why I'm asking that question. Because Nabisco knows exactly what they're trying to produce. Nabisco knows exactly what they're trying to produce. If you and I have children with no knowledge of what we're trying to produce, we have brought a life into the earth realm, and we're playing with trying to produce something. So for those of you who are blessed to not have children right now, and you might have children down the road sometime, you need to realize that this is serious time to lead out in prayer about what you're looking for in terms of raising a godly child. Because many of us did not know these type of things. And I'm, you know, most of the things I learned, I'm learning in my 20s to 30s as I've got serious with the Lord and started reading the Bible on my own. I didn't learn them growing up in Greater Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church. I went to church. I didn't learn them. I learned, won't he do it? Yes, he will. You know, and can I sing this song out and, you know, get him up from the grave? That's what I learned. But when I started reading the Bible for myself, I started saying, man, all this stuff is in here. And like, ain't nobody tell me. You know, all I knew is he died. Didn't he die? And so we'll say that a week from now, you know, Resurrection Sunday. But the deal is that we don't even know what it is that we're trying to produce. And we're thinking that, oh, man, we got us a family. We got a kid. And we're playing around with a kid that God has said from the very beginning, I want you to raise up this kid to reflect my image. And so then what is God's image? What is God's image in order for us to be a reflection of that image? Turn with me in your Bible to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians 3. Colossians 3, verse 9. Do not lie to one another, since you have laid aside the old self with its evil practices, and have put on the new self, who is being renewed to a true knowledge according to the image of the one who created him. God's whole goal is to transform you and I into his image, his character, his likeness, his attitudes, his actions. That's what God's goal is for your life and mine. So we have to know the attitudes, the actions, the character of God in order to say what we're trying to produce in terms of a child that we're trying to raise. And so if I'm in the process of raising a child, the Bible talks about how God will restore the years that the locust has devoured, the book of Joel, chapter 2. In other words, if I have some years that I'm looking on and say, man, I've wasted some time not knowing what I was supposed to do, I don't have to sulk and be sad leaving out of here tonight. But what I have to do right now is say, Lord, I believe in the power of prayer and I believe you answer prayer. And God, there's some things that I know now that I didn't know 3 weeks ago. And Lord, I'm trying to come back to you to begin to bring my child to you, and the Lord will honor that request. So now's not the time to say, man, I blew it. No, no, no. That's past. That's over. Forget what's past. Press on to what's ahead. So now I'm going to move towards what is it that God wants me to do in the raising of this child. And here's one of the things that this generation responds to. This generation, based on this so-called hip-hop culture, thinking that everything in the hip-hop culture is real, they respond to honesty. See, but many of us were trained, you never tell your child that you did something wrong. You don't ever tell your child you did a mistake or anything like that. You know, because Big Mama ain't ever say, boy, you better do what I say. You know, you just do what they say. So the older generation never took responsibility for wrong or things like that. They didn't do that. But this generation responds, hey, let me tell you something, baby. Here's how I blew it. And here's what the Lord showed me. And they respond more than that than they respond, having youth pastored, to people that are telling them, don't have sex. But then they know that you're sleeping with such and such. Okay? So they don't. That's the way this generation. So you can tell them there's some things that I'm learning and growing in right now that I didn't know before. So I'm working with you in a new way, in a new direction. Let's look at this next part. Have you clearly heard from God concerning his desire for your child's life? And what direction has he given you? Let me take you back to Genesis real quick. I'm going to show y'all some stuff in a few minutes, but I want you to check out this question. Have you clearly heard from God concerning his desires for your child's life, and what direction has he given you? Go to Genesis 25, verse 21. One of the things that you'll see in the Bible is you will see in the Bible men praying for their wives about having children. You will also see in the Bible women praying for their children. Praying for their children. And so one of the things about beginning to parent or preparing to parent is that there ought to be some prayer in the process and some conversation with God and some conversation with each other in terms of an agreement based on the word of God of what you're trying to raise up. Check out Genesis 25, verse 21. In Genesis chapter 25, verse 21, it says this. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife because she was barren. And the Lord answered him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. So Rebekah's not able to have children at this point. Isaac prays because she's asking for Isaac to pray for her to have children. Isaac, the father, prays, and they end up having children. We can keep on walking. Hannah is praying for a child in 1 Samuel chapter 1, praying for a child, and she's saying, I'm going to devote this child back to God. Then you're going to have situations to where God is going to come and share with a grown man, a grown son, Joseph, dreams about his life, and or God is going to share before Samson ever comes out on the earth with his mom and dad, what the plan is. God's going to share with Elizabeth and Zechariah what the plan is. And so here's the deal. We have to recognize if God is the author of marriage, if God is the author of sex by which we reproduce children, that God has to be sought in these areas in order to raise up what God desires. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Watch. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. See, God said, in all of your ways, acknowledge me. Don't think that there's a single way of your life that you have the ability to manage on your own. In all your ways, acknowledge me, and I will direct your path. So when it starts coming down to these critical things in life, like having a child, and that child being designed by God, because here's the deal. God is not going to reduce the standard of what he desires because you didn't know. And I didn't know. Oh man, Blake, you ain't know? Man, my fault, man. It's all right. Since you can't make an Oreo, well, let's just do a Chip Ahoy. God ain't doing that. God is going to maintain his standard whether you and I know the standard or not. And so once we know what the standard is, we need to move and adjust what we got coming off the conveyor belt. Amen? Now watch this. So have you clearly heard from God concerning his desire for your child's life, and what direction has he given you? Now, let me, I put that out there for you to think through. We're going to come back to it. What were you or will you be praying for your child while they were in the womb? This is for the, to the ladies. Ladies, what were you or will you be praying? That's in case you have one in the future. Your child while they're in the womb. What solid direction did the king's mother give him out of the womb? Let's go to Proverbs chapter 31. Go to Proverbs chapter 31. I need a lady to read this Proverbs 31. Nathan, if you'll give a lady a microphone. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 1 through 9.
The words of King Lemuel, the oracle, which his mother taught him. What, O my son, and what, O my son of my womb, and what, O my son of my vows?
Stop. Notice where she was praying. Where was the baby?
In the womb.
And she's making vows to God about the child. See, what you got to understand is these people, the Jewish people, the Israelites, were not haphazardly having children. They were intentionally having children because they knew from the word of God that children were a blessing of the Lord. Children were not an accident. People wanted children. They were not an accident. They were not mistakes. They were not wondering if I'm going to be left alone. They weren't wondering that. So go back and read verse 1 and 2 again for me.
The words of King Lemuel. How do you say that? Lemuel?
King Lemuel.
Okay. The words of King Lemuel, the oracle which his mother taught him.
Stop. This is what King Lemuel, the son, is saying what my mama taught me. The book of Proverbs is written by Solomon about what he's teaching his sons. But wisdom has been passed down from mama and fathers, and I'm passing it down to you. And notice this, King Lemuel remembers what his mama taught him. King Lemuel's mama is taking him back in her instruction of him all the way back. Boy, I prayed for you when you was in my belly. That's what she's saying. Boy, when you was in my belly, here's what I was praying for you. Here's what I vowed to the Lord about you. Keep on reading.
What, O my son, and what, O my son of my womb, and what, O my son of my vows? Do not give your strength to women or your ways to that which destroy kings.
Hold on. Lemuel, don't be out there hoeing around.
I'm hoeing.
Lemuel, don't be out there just with all them women. Don't be fooling around, boy. All right, keep on going.
Or your ways to which destroys kings.
Lemuel, do you know who you are? You're a king. You're a king. If you don't know who you are, Doc, you'll just follow the hip-hop culture or some cultural trend or some nonsense. You are royalty, boy. You are a son of God. You are designed to be the builder of the next generation. You are blessed of God. Do you know who you are? You are royalty, son. You ain't hood. You royalty. Keep on.
It is not for kings, O Lemuel. It is not for kings to drink wine or for rulers to desire strong drink. For they will drink and forget what is decreed and pervert the rights of all the afflicted. Give strong drink to him who is perishing, and wine to him whose life is bitter. Let him drink and forget his poverty, and remember his trouble no more. Open your mouth for the mute, for the rights of all the unfortunate. Open your mouth, judge righteously, and defend the rights of those of the afflicted and needy.
Notice this. He says, I want you, Lemuel, to use your position as a king to take care of the needy and the afflicted and for those who can't speak up for themselves. I want you to use your position to be a blessing to somebody else. I don't want you to use your position, Lemuel, for your own favor and your own, you know, your own stuff, your own benefit. So notice what she says. The reason why I don't want you to drink is you're going to forget the decrees of the Lord. You're going to forget the word of God, and you will not know how to legislate and lead properly, and you will pervert the rights of the afflicted people. People who are burdened down, you are a king, and God has given you a platform to bless the burdened and the afflicted. So I need you to open your mouth for the mute and for the rights of the unfortunate. Let me just share this with you. The other day I get a message from someone, and they're telling me about a young lady who is being molested by a family member. And being molested by a family member. And so I said, well, what is the age of the young lady? She said about 7, 8 years old. How old is the person that's molesting them? 15, 16 years old. You know, family member. I said, okay. Well, what did you do? And you know, who knows? Well, I told him she needs to tell her mama. She said, no, I can't tell the mama because grandmama said that, you know, this isn't her, your mama's business. Because grandmama's trying to make sure that the person that's living in her household doesn't get turned in for molesting. So grandma gonna compromise the little 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old girl who'd been being molested the last 3 years, and grandma gonna compromise. But see, you didn't call the problem because you told me about it. And so I tell you, hey, look here, let me tell you something. You better tell somebody. Somebody needs to know about this thing, and somebody needs to know right away. Why? Because you can't tell me the story and just think we're going to be talking about nobody getting molested. So if you call, if you messaging me as pastor, I ain't coming to play with you. You call somebody and you get this thing turned in and da-da-da-da, and we get this thing taken care of. Like, I don't know who the girl is, I ain't seen the girl, but I'm telling you, don't call me playing with no stuff. Because I'm not going to hear that and be like, oh, that's sad. No, we need to put a devil in prison. That's what we need to do. And if Big Mama got to go to prison, she need to go too. Are you following me? Because some people are so sick that you will not use the position that God gave you to speak up for the rights of the afflicted. So when I make you royalty, when I make you a king, I'm not making you a king to drive around and wave around and people to throw confetti on you. And you wave and, you know, no, I'm making you a king for you to take care of the needy people. I'm giving you a position to speak up and talk. And that's why Jesus Christ said, the King of Kings, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to release the captive, to provide recovery of sight to the blind. Jesus Christ, when you look at what he's called and his mission to do, his mission to serve was to serve needy people. And so this woman is praying for her son. Son, I want you to be a man who's able to look back from a high position and see people in a low place and lift them up. See, I ain't praying for the boy. Oh, he could be a basketball player. He can be a doctor. He can be a lawyer. So the reason why I'm asking these questions about what were we praying for our children is because a lot of times our prayers are off. We're praying for successful college graduate. We're praying for successful job. And, you know, so that our kid can be independent and make their money and have their own house, and we don't have to put them on our bills no more. But that's not what Lemuel's mama was praying for. She was saying, son, you already royalty. Now what are you going to do with what you've been given? What are you going to do with the platform? How are you going to serve others? Your job as king is to serve others. You and I are raising servants. If God sends his son, and his son's statement is Mark, is I did not come to be served, but to serve and give my life away as a ransom for many. In other words, I'm the King of Kings. I'm Lord of Lords. And I didn't come to be served. I came to serve and give my life away as a ransom for many. So when I'm parenting, I got to look through a Jesus lens and model and be praying for my child to have a servant nature to where they're willing to lift up other people. I'm praying for my children, and I think I've told you all my three C's. Reagan, she's the oldest. I want you to be a woman of care, concern, and compassion. Three simple C's. I want you to care about people. I want you to be concerned about their problems. And I want you to have the compassion to solve them like Jesus. Robert Chance's three C's. I want you to be a man of character, a man of courage and a man of compassion. I want you to have character like Joseph and Daniel. I want you to have courage like David, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, that's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Nehemiah, who rebuilt the wall. And I want you to have the compassion like Jesus Christ to solve their problems. Three simple C's, that's what I pray for them. You know what the blessing was? In second grade, my daughter was dealing with a little girl by the name of Elena who came to Northland Christian in the first, she missed first grade. They got special little learning things that they do in first grade. And the teacher, we come to parent-teacher conference, and she said, I chose Reagan to mentor Elena through second grade. And so we're like, you chose our daughter to mentor us? She said, the reason why we chose Elena, this is Miss Tate. Miss Tate said, because Reagan is so compassionate and knows how to take time with Elena. And here's something that we've been praying at home, and the teacher said the exact same word. It had zero to do that we were good parents. It had everything to do with God answers prayer. But if you don't put together a legitimate plan on raising your children and pray that plan and speak that plan over the life of your kids, you will raise kids aimlessly. Aimlessly. So now my little man is growing up. How are my prayers evolving for him? My little man is hooping, right? So here's the prayer for him. This is his hooping deal. I want you to be a spirit-filled scholar sportsman. Three S's, spirit-filled, scholar, sportsman. He's doing amazing in school, but that don't mean nothing if he ain't spirit-filled. I want him to be a sportsman. I want him to play ball. He's playing basketball, but that don't mean nothing if he ain't saved. Amen? And so I'm always adjusting based on what I see God doing in his life, my developmental prayers for them. Amen? And so as parents, you got to look intentionally about how are you directing and how is God using your child to go in a certain direction. This is no joke. I don't care if your kid is 6, 7, or 8, they waiting to be prayed on. Now, you say, I don't know, Pastor Blake, maybe I missed it. No, you didn't, because my man Jacob or Israel, he didn't bless his children until he was finna die. So he blessed his boys when he was getting ready to die on his deathbed. So if you're still living, bless your kids right now. Your kids are waiting on a blessing. They're waiting on affirmation. They're waiting on affection from you. They need it from you. Because if they don't get it from you, there is a joker out there. Can I raise my hand? Before I knew a good Jesus? There's a joker out there waiting to take your stuff in a total different direction. Amen? Now, here we go. This last thing we're going to do. Y'all have Judges 13, 1 through 20. How did God reveal his plan for the Israelites to the parents of Samson? And who did God speak to first? And what was the reaction of the other parent? That's for the ladies. That's for the ladies' tables. Judges 13, 1 through 20. Brothers, here's yours. How did God reveal his plan for the Israelites to the parents of John the Baptist? Luke 8, 18 through 18. Who did God speak to first? And what was the reaction of the other parent?